Respected Chief Guest, Professor Gautam Desi Raju, our guest of honor, Dr. Jayant G. Sahasrabuddhe, our Acting Director, Professor Rajiv Prakash, my senior faculty colleagues and friends. I take pleasure in inviting you to this second talk of the Scientists of India lecture series, commemorating or celebrating the 130th birth anniversary of Professor C.V. Raman. May I request the dignitaries to start the function by invocation through garlanding the bust of Malviyaji. Thank you, sir. May I now request our director, Professor Rajiv Prakash, to welcome the gallery.
Very good evening to all of you. It gives me great pleasure to extend to you all a very warm welcome. On the occasion that we are going to celebrate is the 130th birth anniversary of Sir C.V. Ramanji. We are honored to have one of the most revered global scientific personalities, Professor Gautam R. Desi Rajuji, distinguished scientist from IIC Bangalore. I welcome you, sir. I also welcome Dr. Jayant Sahasrabuddhe ji, All India National Secretary Vigyan Bharati. On this occasion, I welcome you, sir. I welcome you all, dear colleagues, students in this lecture series, which is today devoted on the 130th birthday of Sir C.V. Ramanji. Without taking much time, I request to Ramanathan to come up and display the small movie on Sir C.V. Raman and introduce the speaker.
Thank you very much, Professor Prakash. So, what will follow now is a very brief sojourn. Today we have actually twin occasions to celebrate or to pay tribute to. One is the birth anniversary, 130th birth anniversary of Professor C.V. Raman. And at the same time, 12th of November in the Gregorian calendar happens to be the day when the founder of this great university, Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, shed his mortal coil. So it's a twin occasion for us to pay tribute. So now what will follow is a brief life sojourn of C.V. Raman.
It needs a certain do you think, sir, that you need expensive equipment in order to do good?
Well, sir, I wish I had equipment, but I don't have it, so that I've got to get on without it. So the difficulty, there is no question at all that we are in India, we are handicapped in many ways. No money, no equipment, and all the world throwing its goods at us. We have no time to do anything except try to solve what they tell us. You see, and we have no time to think. See, that's all very well. I don't think about it. We have to think well if we find it. Work and think and study and do something about it. Get ideas, test them out. You have to be very honest with yourself. Don't be satisfied with half-hearted explanations. Go to the root of the matter and take photographs, study. Do what you can with what equipment you possess.
Thank you for your patience. Let me now have the pleasure of speaking a few words about I will not call it an introduction because it's a common household name. The areas which are spanning crystal engineering, chemistry, pharmaceutical chemistry, so on and so forth. Professor Desi Raju has had his illustrious career for 30 years at the University of Hyderabad from 1978 until 2009. Since when, he is at IIC Bangalore. He has cautioned not to speak a lot about him in the introduction, but pardon me if I'm stepping and going a bit overboard. He's a member of the editorial advisory boards of Angewandte Chemie, Journal of the American Chemical Society, that is JACS, and Chemical Communications. He is the past president of the International Union of Crystallography during 2011 and 14, and he was the chair of the first Gordon Research Conference in Crystal Engineering, which was held in 2010. He is the recipient of an honorary doctorate degree from the University Nacional de Corbota, Argentina, and the Rayalaseema University, Kurnool, Andhra Pradesh. In 2017, one of the biggest conclave was organized by Professor Desi Raju at Hyderabad, which was Congress and General Assembly of the International Union of Crystallography. His two authored books on crystal engineering and the weak hydrogen bond have around 3,000 and 5,000 sites each. That speaks about the impact of the work he has done, the impact of his work. Apart from other national and international accolades, a few that I would like to mention are the Alexander von Humboldt Forschungs Prize, the World Academy of Science Prize, PC Day Medal from the University of Calcutta, and very recently the ISA Medal of Science 2018 from the University of Bologna, Italy. Professor Desi Raju has been writing on general topics apart from his serious research works on crystal engineering as well as weak hydrogen bonds. He has been writing on general topics concerning the overall education of our country, the policies, the plight of our performance, be it in Olympics or in academics, and several others, and has been published in journals like Nature, Nature India, and Current Science. His thoughts are as clear or perhaps even more than the crystals that he has engineered. I will end this by quoting few of his statements which will give an idea of the wide spectrum of professor's engagement. I quote, "The real tragedy in this era of liberalization is that while politicians have felt the need to abolish the license control permit raj in the financial and commercial sectors, they have not deemed it important enough to extend their experiment into educational and scientific arenas. Indian science has drifted into obsolescence and is finally mired in irrelevance. It only remains for it to be totally drowned in the sewage of its own bureaucratic procedures, managerial wisdom, and willful self-contradictions." And this is not from the recent past, but way back in 1995, Current Science, Volume 68. Just to give another glimpse of his clarity of thoughts in the area of education system as a whole in the country, the title of this scathing article itself should be hard-hitting, which is, "Something is rotten in the state of education." I quote, "Much has been said in these columns about falling standards in our educational system, the lack of demand for courses in science subjects, the need to popularize science among youngsters, and to inculcate scientific temper among the general public. While we scientists continue to ponder about these worthwhile issues in a decent manner, I fear that many of us may be living in a fool's paradise," unquote. His views on, there have been writings of his from 1995 until this year in the Swarajya magazine, but I will end up with two more quotes. This is from Current Science, May 2001, whatever I quoted before. In his Economic and Political Weekly article of June 2008, he goes on to say, and I quote, "Elite institutions are the icing on the cake. It is silly to talk about the icing and revel in it when there is no cake and even no bread. Very questionable are the plethora of scientific agencies and organizations wherein there is much duplication of effort, wasteful expenditure, little quality output, and no accountability. Education is the continuous thread that runs through the fabric of all kinds of creative scientific activity. It is a right at the basic level and a privilege at the higher level. No one, student, administrator, or teacher should be made to forget this," unquote. His title at the Nature 2012 article itself speaks for its volume, "Bold Strategies for Indian Science." And in a nutshell, "For a nation of its talent and education, India deserves higher scientific standing. It needs clear and honest leadership, not more money." So with these few words, I'm assuming that I have given you the wide spectrum of thought processes that professor has engaged with both his student, with the academia, as well as the community. And without much ado, I now request Professor Desi Raju to come and deliver his institute lecture.
Thank you. very much, Ramanathan, for these kind words of introduction. I'm very happy to be here in IIT BHU today. Can people hear me in the last row? You're able to hear? Okay, good. And this evening, I would like to talk to you about some of the thought streams that have been responsible for the growth of chemistry in our country. And I would divide this talk in two portions. In the first portion, largely, I would talk about the development of chemistry in India from ancient times to the medieval period. Because after the medieval period, which is about 1500 AD, science and in general many other things started deteriorating in this country. The second aspect which I wish to cover in this talk is how certain methods of thinking and certain approaches, philosophical approaches, into the nature of knowledge itself, as expounded from our most ancient traditions, are of complete relevance to solving extremely sophisticated modern problems of science that deal with the nature of complexity. Now, the historical aspect of science is important. I mean, you are all faculty and students of IIT BHU. Those among you who are students have come here after a strictly competitive process. You all have all done well in various exams and studied hard to get here. And at the end of this process, you hope to better your prospects, your careers, sometimes get jobs, sometimes go on for further studies. But in the overall assumption that education will lead you to a better place. The teachers are here because they also feel the same thing and they are facilitating this process. What then is the relevance of history, history of science, in activities of this sort? Why should young people be involved in, why should you all even be interested in what I am talking today? I mean, to quote George Orwell, he said that somewhat cynically, he who controls the past controls the future. And even more cynically, he adds in the second line, he who controls the present controls the past. Now, we have met here in a very ancient city which is located in a very young country. I am 66 years old. I was born 5 years after independence. And for my entire life, I have seen this country trying to understand itself or even trying to define what it is. It takes time. Countries are not defined on the basis of what is written in the constitution. Countries are defined on the basis of what its people feel about it. We are a very young country. Before 1947, we were a rather unlucky country, in the sense that we had faced invasions of various types for close to 1000 years. And in a scenario like this, post 1947, we the people of this country, we should not feel impatient that we have still not been able to properly define ourselves. It will take time. But in order to figure out who we are, we need to know at least a little bit of what there was before. Because the period of invasions and the period of external rule was accompanied by, and is always accompanied in any place in the world, it is accompanied by a change in the thought process of the people, which is brought about by the conquerors. This is always, it's always the case. And it's going to take some time for us to figure out exactly who we are. I mean, Churchill actually said that there is nothing called India. He said it's only a geographical construction. He said the notion of India is like the notion of an equator. So different people have had different things to say about our country. And even today, I will use the Hindi word manthan. There is manthan going on in our country as its people are trying to figure out what they are. So for all this, it is very important to have a very clear, dispassionate and scientific, analytical view of what the past was all about. And what better place to go than to look at the history of science itself? You know, there are obviously two ways of looking at this. One is to say that everything that happened in the past is great, and somehow to try to find any sort of a connection between the past and the present. Another thing is to say that nothing that happened in the past was great and it, you know, we have to do something else. So clearly both these views are being extreme views. You know, they are not correct. So, coming to the topic at hand, it is about chemistry, but you don't need to be a chemist to understand my talk. It's more about India and what the peculiar nature of Indian thought was that gave such outstanding contributions in the subject of chemistry. Because I am a chemist, I am talking about chemistry. I dare say this lecture could have been done for a practitioner of any other subject in his or herself. My story sort of begins with this great chemist, Marcelin Berthelot, a Frenchman, whose most famous statement was, "La chimie crée son objet." Chemistry creates its object. And because you see, chemistry is the only one of the major subjects where the researcher is free to make the objects of his research. No other subject has this freedom and liberty. A chemist makes. And what he wants to study, he can make. So if he wants to study something else, he can make that. Making something is very, very important in chemistry. Berthelot said not only this, but something else. And this is where my story begins. And he says here, I'm translating now loosely from the French. "Therefore, it now becomes necessary to examine some documents which I have received, which I have recently signaled to me from a letter of Ray, professor in the Presidency College, Calcutta. According to this scholar, there exist books on alchemy written in Sanskrit that go back to the 13th century. Now, Berthelot was a famous French professor of chemistry. He was also a student of alchemy and chemistry of the past. Who was this man Ray, whom he talks about, professor of Presidency College, Calcutta? Acharya Prafulla Chandra Ray. And I was honored very, very recently and greatly humbled to receive a medal from Calcutta University named after this gentleman. It's a new medal that the university started. And I was greatly, greatly humbled to get anything which has got Acharya P.C. Ray's name, just as I am very humbled to speak in a lecture series which is invoking the memory of C.V. Raman. You know, so these are all people we have to think about. And let me tell youngsters, especially in the audience, the past is to be respected but not worshipped. Take it in full measure, keep it at a distance. Because you people belong to the future, not to the past. And even if Orwell is to be believed, you can take the future in your hands, taking from the past whatever you need to take. I'll come to this topic again. Now, Ray was from a very wealthy family in Jessore, which is now in today's Bangladesh. And he was educated in the best schools and colleges in Calcutta by his affluent parents. He was the second Indian, I believe, to get a PhD. He got a PhD in chemistry in the Edinburgh University. And he did very well there. He came back. He joined Presidency College and did a lot of outstanding work in chemistry. So he was doing international level science from India. He discovered a compound called mercurous nitrate. He did a lot of chemistry on mercury compounds, by the way. But gradually he started getting interested in this subject of chemistry as it was practiced in India in former times. And he wrote a magnificent set of two books, A History of Hindu Chemistry, from the earliest times to the middle of the 16th century AD. And these books constitute the source material for just about anybody who wants to look at the subject of Hindu chemistry and the influences that this has had on the modern day subject. It was certainly my first source book when I started looking into this subject a couple of years ago. And then I became fascinated, because I was able to put in perspective some of the modern problems in my own subject and begin to start feeling that some of these older ideas are absolutely modern in today's context. They are the only ideas that can be used to solve certain modern day problems. Now, as I said earlier, what is chemistry? As Berthelot said, chemistry creates its object. I'll make it even simpler. Chemistry is synthesis. No matter what kind of chemist you are, you either make things or you help somebody to make things. And even modern definitions of chemistry, they are the study of matter, its composition, its synthesis and its transformations. You make things and then you convert one thing to another thing. That is briefly the core activity of chemistry. And chemists do this in two ways. I mean, this is synthesis. you put two things together and get some new thing. And in order to do synthesis, very quickly and very instinctively, any chemist starts doing the second thing, which is called analysis. Analysis means taking a big thing and chopping it up into smaller things. And as I said, it is the chemists do this instinctively. When they see a big thing, they want to chop it up. This chopping up is done mentally or it is done in the lab also. And why do you chop up? You chop up so that you are trying to prove that you can put them back together in the synthesis. So synthesis goes one way, analysis goes the other way. And the first thing you do is you take a known thing and chop it up and try to recreate the synthesis. Then what do you do? You change these things slightly and try to put it back, and so you will get a new thing which you never had before. So you make a new compound. So in this process of synthesis, analysis, analysis, synthesis, that is the passion of the chemist. And you start making millions and millions of things. More compounds have been, more new compounds have been made by chemists since the year 1900 till now than had been made in the whole human history till then. This also leads to other problems like pollution and all that today. When we are making compounds where we don't know what the long-term effects of those compounds will be. So the power of chemistry also becomes its curse. Because today chemists are very good at making anything that they want. But essentially, if you look at chemistry of yore, Hindu chemistry, new chemistry in this country, these ideas of synthesis and analysis come throughout. Let us take analysis. Many ancient civilizations said that the five principal elements, Panchabhuta, ether, air, fire, water and earth, are the five elementary and subtle particles. So, what are these five elements? What is this Panchabhuta? The Greeks had four, you know, they had air, fire, water and earth, and a few people were told about ether, the fifth one, that was kept secret. These were related by the Greeks to the Platonic solids. The tetrahedron, the octahedron, the cube, the icosahedron and the dodecahedron. So different cultures have recognized these five elements. But the Hindus went further and they made it more sophisticated. They said that these Panchabhuta are not the most rudimentary elements. They said there are five elements, all right. But they themselves are made up of these more elementary and subtle particles, which they call Tanmatra. So what are these Pancha Tanmatra? The first one is audibleness. Akasha can be heard. The next one is tangibility or touch. Vayu is both audible and tangible. The next one is color, what can be seen. So Agni is audible, tangible and it has got color. Then the next tanmatra is savor, taste. So Jala is audible, tangible, it can be seen and it can also be tasted. And finally, smell is the most sophisticated of the five tanmatras. Prithvi is audible, tangible, can be seen, can be tasted and can be smelt. So you see, we were thinking entirely different from the Greeks. The Greeks put ether last and they said it was a secret and nobody should be told about ether. We put ether first. See them. Totally contradictory way in which these two great ancient civilizations have been thinking. D.C. Ray found it in his book, and I have found it on reading many of these books. There is a great tendency by Western scholars to say that everything came from Greece. No, many things did come from Greece. But lots of things came from India too. I mean, the famous in the Lalita Sahasranamam, very early in the names, it is said, you know, Mano Rupekshu Kodanda Pancha Tanmatra Sayaka. He is the person who holds the five tanmatras as five arrows in the quiver of the bow, Kodanda. This is how Lalita Tripura Sundari is described. So, tanmatra is, this is a question of, you know, property. So, you can say that everything is made up of ether, air, fire, water, earth. But then I'll say more subtle than that. I'm defining something by not what it is, but by what it does. So, I am putting property above structure. And I am saying that defining something through property is a more accurate way of describing matter than describing something through structure. This is entirely opposite from what, you know, Western science, reductionist science thinks. Because the process of analysis which I told you, it consists of splitting things down in terms of material objects. I am splitting things down here in terms of properties. Now, I am fast forwarding you to the future now, just our paper which we wrote last year. Normally, you know, scientists think that things that have the same structure have the same property. And things that have different structures have different properties. In this particular paper, we showed that things which have the same structure can have different properties. And things that have the same structure can have different structures can have the same property. So, property and structure need not go together. Same structure, different property, different structure, same property is also possible. So, in such a scenario, which is more important, structure or property? Depends what you want. But in today's goal-driven environment, when property is all important, maybe looking at things in terms of properties will lead you to quicker answers than looking at things in terms of structure. This all needs some recalibration on the part of scientists. Now, coming to synthesis itself, now I am trying to cover some 2000 years in one slide. It is not possible. But basically, the art of synthesis started with the Atharva Veda, which is actually sorcery, black magic, witchcraft and all these things. And at the time of the Atharva Veda, they knew about gold and mercury. Not much else is mentioned in those times. You went through the period of Ayurveda and the very famous Charaka and Sushruta, who came about, you know, 1000 years difference from each other. Charaka was from roughly what can be called today Himachal Pradesh. And Sushruta probably is from today somewhere near Kabul or something beyond in Afghanistan side. These were very, very great commentators on chemistry. And after the period of black magic and witchcraft, chemistry started becoming related to medicinal things. Hence this connection with Ayurveda. People like, well, Nagarjuna is a tricky case, we'll come to him later. Vagbhata commented both on Charaka and Sushruta, and he said something which is very, very important and timely for us today. Vagbhata came in the end of the Ayurvedic period. And he said, just because something is old doesn't mean it's true. And as a supporting his point, he said, so many people have come and gone. Why is it we still only remember Charaka and Sushruta? He said, a thing must also be reasonable. It's not just good enough if it is old. This is something we should learn today. Because in our country, in our present day culture, we tend to revere everything that is old. You know, some old scientist is going around 85 years old. He's old. Now, you can't go on saying because he's 85 years old, he is God. Please give a chance to a 55-year-old. Why 55? Even 35-year-old. A 35-year-old may be better. I wrote recently in that article in Nature that we have scientists who are 80, film stars who are 70, cricketers who are 40. This reverence we pay to somebody simply because they are old. Vagbhata told us this ages ago. 2000 years ago he wrote like, we are not listening to him. Then you come to the what is called transition period. Patanjali and the famous Chakrapani, they again commented quite a lot on the people who came earlier. But gradually you find the creeping in of various metals into the writings. And you come into what is called the Tantric period. And you find for the first time this word rasayana. So rasa means juice or nectar or essence. But rasa actually in the chemistry context means substance. Any substance was called rasa. At various documents, gold is called rasa, mercury is called rasa. It simply means substance. And ayana means path. So rasayana is means a path of substances. That is how our modern word for chemistry is. The biggest document from the Tantric period is called Rasarnava. And Rasarnava talks quite a lot about mercury or quicksilver. It is associated closely with Lord Shiva. And that is the Tantric worship of Shiva and Shakti is related to mercury and mica. So there are replete references to mercury. And in fact, Hindus had got a way of even allowing patients to ingest small quantities of mercury, which is today considered a highly poisonous substance. It is actually given as a treatment for leprosy. And many innumerable references to mercury. And then we come into something which can be more easily understood in the modern context, which is called the iatrochemical period, which is when medicinal chemistry and chemistry then became integrated. Metals became a part of medical treatment, the so-called bhasmas. And the most important document of that time is this famous Rasaratna Samuchchaya. So this particular thing is referred to pretty often by P.C. Ray and constitutes many of the original documents that pertain to chemistry. One of the things it says is, the character of fixed quicksilver is that it is continuous, readily fusible, pure, heavy, and it can revert to its own natural state. So what does all this mean? What is this? Quicksilver is mercury, we know that. What is fixed quicksilver? Fixed quicksilver is when mercury is made into its oxide, sulfide, etc., etc. So then, it is readily fusible. It is pure and heavy, apparently it doesn't move and all that, they said. Then there is a form of quicksilver in the labile state starts moving. So then, from today's modern chemistry, we can say that mercury being so low in the electrochemical series, it readily reverts from the metallic state to its compounds. It is very reversible and easy. So you take mercury and make it into the oxide, it will stop moving. It will just become like a lump and sit there. You can heat the oxide very easily, it will start moving again, you see the mercury. So, they put it in a different format. But they had started essential scientific things, that is observing, changing something, observing and seeing what happens. Here is Charaka and a pictorial depiction of him. Another aspect of this is gunpowder. I have many stories I can tell today. Most of our textbooks say that gunpowder was invented in China. This is not true. It was discovered in India. And there is a very authoritative article in the Standard Journal, Journal of Chemical Education. Look at the date, 1948. when people have described, and they said the reason that gunpowder had to be discovered in India was that Bengal was the only place where nitre was available, potassium nitrate in those days. So if you don't have nitre, you can't get gunpowder. And Yuan Sang or somebody has taken the gunpowder technology from India to China, and then it became propagated in the textbooks that the Chinese invented gunpowder. You know, so please remember some of these things. Now I want to move a little faster because, you know, I've really run out of time. These are the 12 elements, chemical elements, that have been known to us since antiquity. That is, from so far back that we don't even know since when. Of the 192 natural elements out of the 130 elements today, 12 of these were known right from the beginning. Now, let's remove the non-metals. We have these metals. And you will notice that many of them are very low in the electrochemical series. In other words, they are not very reactive. The most unreactive of them, of course, is gold. And that's why, and since gold is also very freely available in shallow depths in the rivers, no wonder that gold became gold. It could be easily obtained and it didn't react at all. And it was scarce. It was not common. So therefore it took the place it took. So let's forget about all these less reactive metals from antiquity. See, it is no wonder that gold, mercury, lead and all were known right from the beginning. They are so unreactive that they exist in their natural state. The element is more stable than the compounds. So whatever you do to an ore of lead or mercury and so, you will get the free metal just like that. It is not a rocket science to get these non-reactive metals from their ores. But there are two metals here that are quite reactive. So the question I will ask you is, how did our ancients know about these? Because they are very reactive. They don't exist in their pure form in nature. Now, iron, of course, is a well-known story. Many of you would have heard so many things about iron. So I have decided to select zinc today. Zinc, very funny element. It's a reactive element. It is known right from the beginning. And it's got many uses. It's quite abundant. There is a property of zinc here that I would like to highlight.
I don't know if you can read this. The melting point is 419 and the boiling point is 907.
It is very strange for a metal to have such a small difference between the melting point and the boiling point. There are not many heavy metals which have such a small difference. It's not the melting point that's anomalous. The boiling point of zinc is anomalously low. So, the first thing about zinc is it's very reactive. The second thing which I want to point out is that the boiling point is very low. Now, the main ore of zinc is zinc carbonate, calamine, which exists in pretty large quantities in India. It exists everywhere. In India, it is located mostly near Udaipur in Rajasthan. Still there. There is an India zinc and aluminium refinery still there near Udaipur. The ores are still there, and our ancients figured out a way to extract this highly reactive element from its ore. Extracting a reactive metal is quite difficult. Extracting an unreactive metal like gold and lead and tin are very easy. Now, what did the Hindu chemists know about zinc? Both Rasarnava and Rasaratna Samuchaya say it's the mineral that turns copper into gold. And if you know, one of the goals of alchemists was to make everything into gold. What was actually going on? Calamine. There are three kinds of it, namely of yellow color, of the appearance of treacle. No wonder is it that Rasaka mixed with certain organic matters and roasted three times with copper converts the latter into gold. there are also names for this. The Europeans used to call Chinese zinc as Dutanaga. There's an old Sanskrit Tamil word, Dutanagam, which means zinc. The Sanskrit word is Tuttam. And many other compounds of zinc used to be called by names similar to this. Madanapala recognizes it as a metal, calls it Jasadam. There is a stotram also in this. Jasada Ranga Sadrisham Nitihetu Yutu Tanmatam. So what is this business of calamine and turning copper into gold and all that? You see, as modern inorganic chemists, we can recognize, if you take zinc carbonate and heat it, you will get zinc oxide. And if you take zinc oxide and heat it in a reducting atmosphere, like with charcoal or something like that, it is converted into zinc in situ. Zinc alloys with copper to give brass, which is gold colored. So this is the business of turning copper into gold. And there are elaborate treatises on how much calamine you have to take, how much charcoal you have to take to get gold of different colors apparently. You know, you go to some Maharaja or something and take copper and start heating all this, suddenly it looks like a golden colored thing coming out. You'll think you have converted into gold. I mean, nobody knew anything in those days. I mean, so the fact is that this is the first clever thing. When zinc is so reactive that it is difficult to convert it into the pure metal, they somehow figured out a way of making it in situ, what we call today in chemistry in situ, and doing the alloying in situ so that copper is converted into brass straight away. So that is all these things. This is a treacle and roasted three times. Many of these ancient texts have to be read in this way. Treacle doesn't really mean honey or something. You can't take these things literally. But you must see in the modern chemical context how this happens and what happens. Now if you see how distorted the Western texts talk about it, this is from a standard textbook of inorganic chemistry. It was standard 100 years ago. He says, Paracelsus uses the word in the 16th century, appears in the writings ascribed to Basil Valentine, and then he talks about Tuttanego, Indian thing, he says calamine. He is very vague about the whole thing. But if you read a little more about Paracelsus and Basil Valentine, who were alchemists of 15th, 16th century AD, they said zinc was not even a metal. In fact, Paracelsus, in a German text, he was from Switzerland, he said, "Keine Malleabilität hat er." It doesn't have malleability. And therefore, it's not a metal. Paracelsus called zinc a bastard metal. Basil Valentine called it a pseudo-metal. They never even identified it as a metal. 4 centuries before that, people in India figured out how to extract pure zinc. Forget alloying with brass. How did they do it? If you go to this place, Zawar, near Udaipur, you will still see traces of these old zinc furnaces. It is called distillation per descensum. Distillation by descending. Usually when you distill something, the vapors go up, you know. Here they had figured out a technique where the vapors come down. And why did they do something like that? Various recipes are given here. We will not go through all the time. You can read this one. Basically what he is doing is he takes calamine, carbonate. He converts it into the oxide by roasting it. Then he reduces with the carbonaceous matter to zinc vapor. The reducing blue flame of CO was substituted by white flame of zinc vapor. Now look, this is easier shown in this diagram. What does he do here? He takes calamine. The ore is mixed with charcoal, roasted to give zinc oxide. Add more charcoal. He needs some more charcoal to reduce it. Salt, borax, clay, cow dung, urine, many things were cow dung he puts. He makes it into balls and puts it here. The furnace is on the top, and the distillation is below. So this is the distillation per descent summit coming down. And now this boiling point, melting point thing comes. The boiling point of zinc is low, 907. Above 940, zinc vapors start oxidizing back to zinc oxide very easily because it is quite a reactive metal. If you look at the electrochemical series, zinc comes quite high. It gets oxidized. So what he needs to do here is, he puts a reed. Some reed is put here. He puts two chambers, the lower containing chamber and the upper furnace. The division between the chambers is in the form of non-mortared bricks. So there are bricks here which are non-mortared. That means things can go through the bricks. Then what does he do? He puts this reed. And the reed is like, you know, today you write so many papers in Chemcom, JAKS and all that about the sensors. They had figured out the sensor for a temperature of between 900 and 940. That is between the boiling point and before the decomposition point. And the temperature at which that reed burnt off and sealed the container, at that particular temperature was the temperature when the blue flame of carbon monoxide is replaced by the white flame of zinc vapor. So exactly the reed is so made that it burns off and seals at this point. And then the vapors on top have nowhere to go except through the mortared bricks and come down. See how clever this is. This is actually something quite dangerous. This is distillation of a closed system. Because there is something on the top, something at the bottom, the whole thing is closed and heated. How does it not blow up? It doesn't blow up because the vapors are coming and condensing. So as they come down and condense, it creates a vacuum. So that is why the whole thing doesn't blow up from the top. And as this reduction is going on, more and more zinc is coming to the bottom. And when it comes to the bottom, it's prevented from the mortared brick from further oxidation. Now look, all these things you cannot do with coincidence. You have to do it with a great deal of theoretical knowledge, experimental knowledge, everything. The Hindu chemists were able to extract zinc 4-5 centuries before Europeans even identified it as a metal. These guys knew everything. Now, enough credit has not been given. And this is the role of scholars of chemistry and scholars of history of chemistry also. To set the record right, there are some articles written by Indians on zinc metallurgy. But it is not written in a way that will counter the arguments given in Partington and all those textbooks. You needed a chemical knowledge of a pretty sophisticated type before you can start doing all these things. I hope that at least that part of the message has gotten through to you. Now I'll go a little fast. If I am given another 10 minutes or so, that I'll now come to the idea of thoughts, Indic thought in solving modern problems of complexity. Emergent properties, supramolecular chemistry, systems biology, all these things we talk about today are discussions on things that where the something becomes more than the sum of the parts. Whether why do ants walk in a straight line? Why do birds fly in a V? Why do people assemble in certain ways? Cells, musical notes. Why does a collection of musical notes sound like a raga? Why is a raga much more than just the musical notes which are constituted? Remember what I told you about properties? That you can have the same thing with different properties. In both Hindustani and Carnatic systems of music, we have ragas which have exactly the same notes but which sound different. For those of you who are aficionados of Hindustani music, I can mention, you know, Puriya, Marwa and Sohini. And for those of you who like Carnatic music, I can talk about Darbar and Nayaki. Same notes, they sound completely different. Same structure, different properties. We were using these kinds of thinking in all our creative activities. It was not just chemistry, music is everywhere. So emergent properties are characteristic of complex systems. This is something that the Westerners came to this inevitable conclusion after the reductionist ideas had exhausted them and they could not do any more with reductionism. Then they realized that there is something more than reductionism. And that's how they came to complexity and emergence. This is my subject is a part of this sort of a thing, but I am not going to bore you with what my subject is. It is a part of something called supramolecular chemistry, and it again deals with the crystal structures. For example, when we put them together, the constituents may be the same, but the ways in which we can put them together are different. I'll come to Nagarjuna. There are actually two Nagarjunas. One was a Buddhist monk who lived around 2nd, 3rd century AD, after whom Nagarjuna Sagar, Nagarjuna Konda in Andhra and all are named. There was a second Nagarjuna, but he was also a chemist, by the way. That part of the confusion comes from that. He did write on some chemical things. The important chemist Nagarjuna lived, they say, somewhere in Maharashtra or Gujarat. They are not able to figure out exactly where he came from. But when I told you about putting things together and you don't know what this whole is more than the sum of the parts, see what he has to say. For the sprout does not exist in the seed, which is its cause. It does not exist in each one of earth, water, fire, wind and so forth, which are agreed to be its conditions. It does not exist in the combinations of conditions, nor in the combination of causes and conditions, and yet it does not exist as separate from these, free from causes and conditions. So in other words, you need everything. 40 years I have been looking at these crystals. I couldn't have put it better than this. Basically all my 400 papers I have been here summarized in one paragraph. So this whole idea about causes and conditions, again structure and properties, it's the same theme. The final emergent property, whatever is the property, that is at a higher frame of reference than the earlier reductionist one, which is merely structure. I think that is the sort of a thread and the theme which runs through much of our ancient thought, which then can come into very modern things. Take Mendeleev and this whole idea of intuitive knowledge. Now Mendeleev, as we all know, discovered this periodic table in the late 1860s, especially after Cannizzaro showed the atomic weights of the elements. There was a fierce competition in Europe to try to see. They all knew there is some systematic thing, organization of these elements. They all knew that. But they didn't know what the pattern was. And there were many people in this game. The two most leading fellows were Mendeleev and a German fellow called Lothar Meyer. And both of them produced something which looks like the modern periodic table. But actually today, after 150 years, Mendeleev gets all the credit for this discovery and Lothar Meyer gets nothing. What is the reason? Now, this is just for fun. I was able to recently pull out a copy of the periodic table, and those of you who have got good eyesight, you can see that, you can come and see the slide later. It is in Kannada. And this is from a rather old book. I come from Bangalore, I said, for some fun, I'll bring this and put it here. It is from a rather old book, 1944, The Great English to Indian Dictionary, it's called. It's published by the director, the International Academy of Indian Culture, Lahore, India. 1944, and for use in the various Aryan and Dravidian languages of India and Ceylon, Bengali, Gujarati, Hindi, Kannada, etc., etc. And for some reason that I don't really know, volume 1 deals with chemistry. So this book came into my possession recently, and so I pulled out this Kannada periodic table from there. And so you see, this is a worldwide thing, but to really look at the periodic table and pay due homage, you have to see it in Russian. So this is Mendeleev's thing, and what did Mendeleev do that Lothar Meyer could not do? You see, when Mendeleev put his periodic table, all these elements were not known. Only 60 of them were known. And some of them, as I said, were known from antiquity. 12 of them were known all the time. And then other things kept getting discovered. So there is nobody to say that which one would be known and which one would be not known. So what Mendeleev did was, instead of simply arranging it in form of atomic weights, he started taking properties. Once again, see the emphasis on properties and not structure. For example, chlorine, bromine, iodine. He put them together. Lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium. He put them together. Those were all known. Then what he did, which Lothar Meyer did not do, he came up with some problem. He had aluminium. He had indium. Gallium was not known in Mendeleev's time. Okay? So he knew aluminium, he put indium. He put them in the same column. And where gallium was supposed to be, he just left it blank. And then he went on to the next one. He didn't. Germanium also was not known. He put a blank there. And then he came to this very old element, arsenic, which is known since antiquity, and then he put arsenic. So he left two gaps for gallium and germanium. He left it like that. And then he did something that no Western scientist would have done. He said, one element will be discovered with the atomic weight so-and-so, with the color so-and-so, with the density so-and-so, with the oxide having so-and-so properties. And he gave all the properties of this thing called gallium. And he was a great aficionado of Sanskrit. In the middle 19th century, there were a number of influential European scientists who were looking towards Sanskrit quite a lot. So this mysterious element that was not known, he called it Eka Aluminium. He said Eka Aluminium will have all these properties. A few years later, this famous Eka Aluminium, now called gallium, was discovered by a French chemist called Lecoq. And Lecoq did all the things, and then he wrote to Mendeleev, "Dear Professor Mendeleev, I got your element, but you have written some wrong things. The density of this new element is not so and so, but it is so and so, which is less than what you have written." So Mendeleev looks at the letter. Immediately he wrote the letter. He said, "Your experiment is wrong, go and do it again. You purify the stuff, your stuff is not fully pure. You purify it and then come back and tell me the density." So Lecoq goes back. He does the experiment. And then he has to then, you know, sit in front of Mendeleev and said, "Sir, you are correct. I have purified this and the density is what you have said it is." So, this, by the way, dear friends, is not the Western way of doing science. And Lothar Meyer, being a German, simply was unaware that he could even do something like this. That is to state some result without an experiment. Mendeleev was sure. And I always feel that the difference between Europe and Asia comes somewhere between Berlin and Moscow. By the time you come to Moscow, you start thinking enough like Asians. These are things which we do typically. This is called intuitive thinking. And intuitive thinking, one of the greatest masters of this subject, a former vice chancellor of this university, has this to say: the true test of knowledge is certainty, which is a characteristic of intuitive thinking. Certainty, He was certain that it was gallium had these properties. Rather than communicability, which characterizes intellectual knowledge, intuition does not oppose intellect but rather lies beyond it. Unless you have read thousands of books and unless you have that much of experience that Mendeleev had, you cannot make that intuitive jump into a correct conclusion. Otherwise, if you intuition without adequate intellectual knowledge becomes like blind guesswork, that's all. It is not really knowledge. Intuitive knowledge, although it does not contradict the necessity of reason, questions the sufficiency of reason. This is very important. There is a place beyond which reason alone cannot take you there. Intuition is not illogical but superlogical. In summary, both intellect and intuition must be synergized in the quest for the nature of ultimate reality. Every organic chemist knows Kekulé and the cyclic structure of benzene. The man was so tired, he was going through so much of mental torture, wanting to know how a composition like C6H6 could even be satisfied by the rules of valence. It was too unsaturated. And finally, he was so tired, he was just sort of a half dream. He saw the fire in there. It was winter time. He saw the fire and then he saw the flame turning round and round. And then suddenly it got to him like that. He said, "Oh my God, this is a ring. I am fooling around with straight chain structures." And then the next morning when he wrote the paper, you see, they were writing very interesting papers that day. He said, "Gentlemen, you must dream," he said. And what is this dreaming? Philosophers like Radhakrishnan and all will talk about this. This is in regular philosophy books. There is awake, asleep, and then the dream state. When you are dreaming, you are not asleep. Other things in your consciousness are quite active when you are dreaming. When Kekulé said, "Gentlemen, you must dream," people were killing themselves to get the DNA structure. All sorts of famous people came. They couldn't get. Pauling couldn't get it. Then suddenly two upstarts called Crick and Watson, they came. And then they made that jump from intellectual knowledge to intuitive knowledge. And they said the base pairs A and T, C and G go together. Suddenly everything, all experimental results of the last 20 years suddenly fell into place. So somewhere in great scientific discoveries, especially where the complexity is involved, that intuitive thinking comes in. It must come in because intellectual knowledge alone cannot take you to those solutions. And this is, I would feel, one of the biggest contributions of Indic thought, Hindu thought, holistic thought, to solving absolutely modern problems. There is nothing old-fashioned about periodic table in Mendeleev's time or benzene structure in Kekulé's time. They were all front-grade scientific problems of the day. It was not some excuse to do something. And this brings me sort of to the end of my lecture. And I must say that anybody who comes to this city is touched by this city. You can't come here and not be touched by this place. And this is the first time I am actually giving this lecture. And as I was telling Dr. Ramanathan, I prepare quite heavily before I start giving a talk. And I have been reading on this topic for several years before I dared to give this talk the first time. And I was wondering where to give it, and then I thought I got this invitation from Banaras. So to talk about this particular subject, I felt there's no better place than Banaras to speak on this. So, you know, who am I? Who are all of you in this? As I said, I started this talk by saying we are in a very ancient city, in a very young country. So I must say that I will only say what everybody here says, Vishvesham Madhavam Dungin, Dandapanim Cha Bhairavam, Vande Kashim, Guham, Gangam Bhavani Manikarnika. So I'd really like to thank you for your attention and thank all the people who have been with me all these years. And I hope that I've tried to communicate a bit of thing. I told in the beginning that we have to know what we can be, we need to know what we were. And we need to know this accurately and correctly, not with mumbo jumbo and various other things. And I said one extreme is bad, the other extreme is worse. And I think this is the role of the scientist really. Serious scientists should start looking at our serious things of the past with the seriousness that they deserve, because some of the fellows I have spoken about over the last 3000 years, they were all extremely skillful scientists and chemists. Otherwise they could not have come up with what they came up. And we have to therefore treat all of them with, as I said, respect them, but don't worship them. Thank you very much.
I would like to take this opportunity to welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bhatnagar sir. Some 2-3 quick questions we can take.
We would like to have your advice on how to incorporate these ideas into our curriculum, especially for engineering students. We have foundation courses in chemistry and we have open electives later on in the curriculum. So how to incorporate these ideas in the manner that we don't go overboard with the reverence for the past and we have the scientific rigor as well?
Good question. I think, you see, I was just telling some of your faculty, whether it's IIT, BHU or BHU, I believe that old universities in India have got a great advantage because you have tradition. Universities go through ups and downs, but you have a certain basic rubric, and in a big old university like this, you will have the flexibility of having elective courses conducted, say, jointly by somebody in history and somebody in chemistry. I mean, just take P.C. Ray's Volume 1 as a textbook for the course. That's enough. And it is not difficult, I'm sure, in this place to find notable experts in Sanskrit, of which you need a little working knowledge to understand some of the things. You know, one of the statements which I told you about that. You have got to figure out sometimes what the old things mean. The character of fixed quicksilver is that it is continuous, readily fusible, pure, heavy, and that it can revert to its own natural state. I mean, if you take some statement like that literally, then it doesn't mean anything. But you've got to know, you've got to have a Sanskrit person, you've got to have a historian, and you need a chemist. So you need a little bit of work put in. And I feel that you would have to prepare a course, maybe even half a course, 15 lectures or 20 lectures, and give it as an elective and try to float it. And all your faculty and all, you're all serious people. So once you get people who are a little bit interested in this, like I knew nothing about this topic 2 to 3 years ago. And then I started reading, I started getting interested. Mostly because of Nagarjuna's quotation, which I knew from some time. And a chance remark made to me by Professor Lane, who, as you know, got the Nobel Prize for supramolecular chemistry in 87, when I was talking to him once, he said, "What you are saying is something called molecular psychology. So do molecules have a thought process? Do they do certain things in a certain way because they want to do it like that, or, you know, something like that?" So these are not comfortable ideas for hardcore scientists. But that remark actually, it was made many years ago to me, but it triggered off something in me. So when I started seeing what Nagarjuna had said, I started reading more and more and more about this topic. So then I said, these are the sorts of things. I think you have to, whenever you float a new course, at least I have found in Hyderabad and Bangalore, you try it like a test balloon on a small scale first. See whether the idea floats. And then gradually you can, you know, bring it. But I can see from the body language of the students and all here that it is a topic, if it is taken seriously and taught properly, I think any intelligent person today will appreciate and pick up. I mean, why is Cornell University doing so much research work on Sanskrit? Why are they taking away, you know, young boys who are brought up in the Vedic traditions and then taking them to Cornell and keeping them there and trying to make them interact with the computer science department? It is because they see a direct link between certain features in Sanskrit grammar and the working of computers. So, I mean, it's pretty much a matter. I mean, like, I was fascinated with zinc because an element that is so reactive and which has got such a low boiling point and can get oxidized so easily, how did these fellows figure out a way of making it in pure form? Then the more I read about this topic, I mean, I've just given a fraction today of what I've read about zinc. But it's really fascinating. And like this, there are so many stories. And to make an interesting course, especially for engineering people, there's got to be a story element and a science or subject element. So I would feel that things like this, it just needs a couple of interested people to come and put it together. You can't do this in an ICER, for example. I'll say frankly, I'm in BHU. BHU has lasted 100 years. No ICER is going to last 100 years, I'm telling you that. I will put an affidavit on that. Because the manner in which this university was started is not the manner in which ICERs were started. So there's got to be something going. I was telling the faculty, 100 years if something had lasted in India means it's pretty good. Have its ups and downs, right? No, that's not the issue. And today, especially in today's aspirational era, where many of our young students are also studying in India and taking up jobs in India, the first generation will be those who simply want jobs for the salary. Okay, 10-15 years you let them get the salary, after that they'll get bored of salary, they'll want to do something else, little bit more intellectually stimulating. And I think places like BHU have to already get themselves ready for that kind of a phase. And you have to really, as I said, respect the past but don't worship the past. So Malaviya ji had some ideas. It's up to all of you to realize those ideas in today's context. Can we do something like, you know, 500 years before Westerners knew that zinc was a metal, we knew how to extract it in a pure form. Can we do that today in chemistry? Okay, telescope time scales, make 500 years into 50 years. Can we do something in India in chemistry today, 50 years before the rest of the world? Should be able to. But our fellows have done it. It's not that we didn't do it. Same people were roaming near that river and the ghats that looked just the same when they were doing extracting zinc. Not much change has happened there as far as I can see. So whatever was good enough for them should be good enough for us. I do believe that's the way to look at it. I'm not just saying this for fun, because 30 years I worked in a university which had absolutely no facilities. And Dr. Ramanathan quoted, money is important, but you certainly, money is not a sort of a necessary condition always to do certain kinds of things. You can do many things with moderate, you can't do with no money at all, but you can do something. One of the things you can start easily is something. And once you get a couple of PhD scholars who can actually look into PC Ray's book and start, that is already 120 years old, put it in a modern form today and give it a translation in modern chemistry, that itself is a topic for 10 PhD theses. You know, all depends on how you look at something.
Sir, I like the way you interwove the property concept and the intuition concept. And I was wondering that the Indian philosophy, ancient Indian philosophy, certain places there are quite clear underpinnings of this kind of thought. Was there a cohesive training through which these people went through? That is why this thought process or intellectual underpinning is so widespread among these ancient people who contributed widely to all these things.
Give a light answer only, because for a heavy question like this, only a light answer will do. Today so much discussion is going on what the Indian nation is. What you have described is the Indian nation. It is that unconscious communication. Nagarjuna of the 10th century AD came from somewhere near Maharashtra, Gujarat. And he commented in detail on what Charaka did 2000 years prior to him. The same Charaka who was living in today's Himachal. How did all this news get through? And Rasarnava, which I mentioned from the Tantric period, even at the time of P.C. Ray, it was available only in two places in India, in the Raghunath Mandir in Kashmir and in the Madras Museum. It had vanished from the rest of the country, but still there were two copies. How did that manuscript go to Kashmir? Can I ask? What were the means with which they were communicating to each other? These are all today's research problems. But it is clear that there was one unified, broad scheme of thought that enveloped this whole thing, what I tried to convey today. You can call it holistic, you can call it intuitive, you can call it this or that. And that's what Bhagavata says. It is not that something is old that makes it good, but something is reasonable which is good. Nothing in our, you see, in our Shastras also, it is written that even ideas of religion have to be set aside if scientifically they are not holding up. Our Shastras are very, very clear on this point. That reasonableness, rationality, that came highest in Hindu thought, which is why the nature of Hinduism is so different from the other religions. Because in many of these cases, I would say that practically all the cases, we put the mind above the heart. I think if you ask me, that is the character of our country. The essential character, if you ask me, I think it is somewhere there. And once you are ruled by the mind and you are not ruled by the heart alone, there is hope for you, especially in today's world.
May I now request our King Director, Professor Rajiv Prakash, to felicitate the speaker. Noteworthy to mention that this was organized with the cooperation of Vigyan Bharati as well. So thank you, Jayan ji, for your presence as well as for this cooperation. May I now request Dr. Puneet to give the vote of thanks, please.
Thanks, Raman. At the outset, this lecture was very engaging, very interesting. We wish we could have more such sessions from Sir in future. And I also thank the Honorable Vice Chancellor to give us his graced us with his presence. Also, Jayanji with his time, and of course, Professor Rajiv Prakash, and all the volunteers who have made this lecture possible, because a lot of things that go in the background, these students help us. And of course, the audience who have found time to attend this lecture. I know that many of our colleagues are busy with preparing for the examinations. Of course, the students are also busy preparing for examinations. So thank you, audience, for this wonderful evening. Thank you.
Before I bring this event, colorful event, to a close, I have two announcements. One is that high tea is waiting for us after this lecture, so please participate in having this high tea. Second is that the next month we will be celebrating the birthday of the mathematician Ramanujan, but owing to the exam period of the students, we have postponed the birth celebration of Ramanujan to the month of January. Professor C.K. Raju is going to be delivering the next institute lecture to celebrate the birthday of Ramanujan, which will be also followed by a one full day workshop by Professor C.K. Raju. You are all invited for the same. Thank you very much.